Thank you very much, Frank. Good morning, everyone. As far as we're concerned, this is the most important session of the entire meeting, because what we're going to spend a little bit of time doing is really looking ahead. I mean, one of the things I always remind people about, if you can imagine, some time ago, there was something somebody invented called the airplane that managed to contribute enormously to the Caribbean. We couldn't imagine how important it was. Then along came something called the internet, which was the greatest contribution to tourism since the invention of the Caribbean, but nobody saw that coming ahead. So we're going to spend some time looking at today, in addition to some of the things we know about our region regarding the impact of Cuba, what is happening with Zika, what is happening with the sharing economy, what is happening with a whole variety of things. So we have a number of experts here today, and in the interest of saving as much time as we possibly can toward the end so you can ask questions and contribute to this discussion, I'm going to go immediately into introducing our first speaker, who I'm going to also save a little bit of time by inviting you to go and take a look at their bios in the program, and so we can get directly into the meat of what we want to talk about. Our first speaker as part of the group today is Mr. Fred Lounsberry, who is CEO of the Nassau Plazas Island Promotion Board. And with that, invite Fred to come and join us. Thank you.
Thank you, Vincent, and it's great to be here, everybody. I guess we started looking at what to talk about this morning, the Caribbean through the looking glass and like getting ahead of the future. It's a little mind-boggling, I think. You get focused on, you know, what you're doing this quarter, next quarter, and since in this business, the tourism business, you always have to be several quarters ahead. It's tough to get beyond that, but, you know, I found we really have to. And I think when I look back, I made a list for today of kind of the things that, what are the things to really, that have changed and are changing before our very eyes. And this is the list, I could have had 20 on this, Cuba, on and on and on, but I focused on a few of these just to have a kind of a variety of things. Airlift. If I'd done this list 10 years ago when I started this position, that would have been the only thing on the list among everything you see there, because all of these things have really happened since and continue to evolve. But airlift, millennials, the buzzword, and I want to talk about a bit. Digital marketing, changing dramatically every day. OTT media. Who knows what that is? I didn't till I had my agency talk about it, but I'll give you a little. It's going to impact everybody that advertises. Native content, another new buzzword, social media, of course, and then VR 360. So I'll just talk a bit about airlift. It's our lifeline, everyone here. It's changed and is changing. I think we have gone to the situation where it wasn't too hard to get air service. The airlines loved the Caribbean. They were very, you could, get Lyft much easier than you certainly can today. Today, the airlines are, in some situations, cutting capacity, or certainly managing it. They're managing their yield. They're not, if a flight isn't in the 80% load factor range, it's going away. And you know, the old talk about revenue guarantees, ironically, they're not as, the airlines want to go somewhere that they're going to be there for years and years. They're not looking for the quick buck to do a revenue guarantee, take a big chunk of dough and pull the service. They want to be there long term. And while revenue guarantees still are needed to kind of get things going, it's really up to all of us to drive the demand. And I get to ask the question all the time about Bahamar, when it comes on stream, what are you going to do about airlift? It's real simple. If there's demand, there will be airlift. We have to move the demand. We'll have to prime the pump a bit, but no airline is going to just do things on the come. So airlift remains vital. The nature of the airline industry needs to be paid attention to. They're all doing pretty well now, which is great. They've always been very pro our region. But again, it's up to us to drive the demand. And when Nassau Paradise Island looks at new lift or added lift, it always, the discussion always comes back to what marketing are you putting behind it? And if you put all your money into revenue guarantees, you have no money for marketing. So it's a very dicey thing these days. And I know there are challenges in many, many islands, but it really is dependent on the airline business and the industry, how we work with them. And we're working with them very differently. And my guess is we'll be working with them very differently 5 years from now. Millennials. Here's a slide that I'm not giving any away in trade secrets. This is some research we do on the age group, the segment that is interested in coming to our destination in the next 2 years. And as you see, millennials, half. And while we track what segment we are getting now, that is definitely a segment of audience of opportunity. You know, the boomers, and I guess I'm an older boomer. I'm not sure where that the boomer and older boomer shakes out, but it's not really shocking because they are the biggest segment of the population in the U.S. now. But the key with millennials is how they think and act and what they respond to. Their psychographics are very different and need to be marketed to very differently. They're heavy users of the internet, obviously, but they're looking for authentic experiences. They're looking for something unique and different. They love the beaches, they love everything we have, but it is not just showing them a beach and a hotel room. They're coming for the experiences. They're coming to go on the cruises, go swim with the pigs in the Bahamas. Those kind of things are what is going to get their attention. And they consume media very differently, and they want to live through the experiences. They're looking for that, not things. So, big segment that demands our attention. And again, 6 months from now, things will be different. We learn more, and I think the main point here is focus on what how advertising has changed. One of the best millennial commercials that I've seen is Royal Caribbean. They're doing a whole, this is not the Caribbean, it's the Royal Caribbean. And it's a totally different style of music. They shoot it with GoPros, the small cameras that, in fact, in some cases, they give out, my sources say they gave out 50 GoPros to passengers, let them shoot, and saw what they got to get that kind of visual versus a formal ad, you know, Madison Avenue type commercial. And so they've figured it out. And I tried to get one on here on YouTube and I couldn't make it work. But just go on YouTube and look for the new Royal Caribbean commercials and I think you'll see what I mean. Information sources, the whole digital world. I think if you, this is again, and I think it's important. We all know everybody looks for information on the internet, but what we went out to understand is where do you get inspiration for commercial? Because that's where it all starts. Where are you going to get your idea for a vacation, what you want to do, where you want to go? And internet still is number one. And I think 10 years ago, a lot of those in the bottom half, and I won't go through them all, would have definitely come up much closer to the top. 10 years ago, we spent a lot of money in newspaper, and we still do some, but it's been a total flip-flop. And of course, the one constant that still is, it's usually number one or one or two, is recommendations for friends and relatives. So it's still delivering that phenomenal experience and the word of mouth. The word of mouth now is through mostly social media, but it's still about delivering the experience. So, as I say, the internet is still the mothership, and of course your desktop, your standard computer, tablets, and mobile. And I know you've seen all these stats, but mobile is now the majority of the visits on travel. 40% year-over-year growth. 69% of travelers who are smartphone users, and I'm sure, well, I see about half of you looking at your smartphone right now. They use it for ideas for travel. Now, they're gonna get the ideas, and whether it's standing in line, checking into a flight or in the subway or wherever, but that is where people are spending their spare time, looking at their smartphone. Now, once they select that, they will come back to the desktop, but the mobile web visitation is growing exponentially. Here's a typical consumer planning a vacation, and 87% of these instances happen on a mobile unit. This is Amy. She had 419 digital moments searching for a trip over 2 months. She looked at 5 videos. She visited 360 web pages and did 34 searches. Our results shadow this very, very, very closely. We are at 56% of our site traffic is on mobile, and it's up 54% from just last year. So, and one of the key things is the content that you create, whether it's video, visuals, one of the key elements is making sure it looks, it needs to look as good on that big screen that you're looking at as on mobile. So there are nuances that have to be adhered to, but you want it to look the best it can be on this thing. And as I mentioned, video, 64% of the folks look at videos when they're planning a trip. It's all about content. 63% use travel videos when they're choosing a destination, and 51% when considering lodging. There's been a 60% growth in travel-related views on YouTube, and that's 2 million in-market travelers every month, new travel watchers each month on YouTube. TV, not everybody here advertises on television, but I suspect a majority do. The media landscape is changing dramatically. OTT refers to over the top. I had no clue what that meant when the agency said, yeah, over the top. They used it like you would use any buzzword. And that's basically the fact that all of the way television is viewed is now coming through a lot of different sources, some that block TV commercials or make them skippable. Here are the devices. And I didn't know what Roku. Does anyone use Roku here? Okay, that's not as many as I thought. So, well, you're half of the people use Roku, Apple TV, Amazon Fire. The bottom line is content, and it kind of goes back to millennials and how they are consuming media is changing dramatically. In talking to some of the traditional advertising outlets, networks, and that, they haven't really figured this out yet themselves. It's making it harder for them to sell their advertising time because this is becoming a bigger and bigger piece every day. The other buzzword is native content, and this is just starting. But what it really is some of the networks are now doing 2 and 3 minute advertising pods. In other words, it's trying to make it all kind of fit with the programming. On Saturday Night Live, you might see the Saturday Night Live talent doing the commercial. And it does give the opportunity with some of these networks to have a long form that really fits with that audience and is not so abruptive and it's not deal kind of advertising. Again, it's just starting, but it is as you look forward, it's something to keep an eye on. And of course, social finally is not, basically video has become the huge driver there as well. And I think we're all learning and have learned more and more about social as we've, over the past couple of years. And it's really about, we always say, well, how do you deliver? Well, we look at it as that success is how we drive people to our website. It's all about driving engagement and engagement enough to say, I'm interested, I'm gonna go there and check. And now the great thing is you can measure it and understand exactly what social is delivering. Of course, TripAdvisor and those are all on a bit of a different plane as far as really being able to manage your product and understand your customers. But the Pinterest, all of those are huge for driving interest in your destination or product. And again, video is number one, and user generated is top of the heap. They don't want to see a slick commercial. They want to see something that is genuine and authentic, that they know is done by somebody like them. And I'll leave you one last thing, is the whole 360 VR, virtual reality. It's just starting to trickle out, but this is kind of the next step. It's very adaptable to it's not just a trade show gimmick, adaptable to websites. Very, very, in fact, we're going to produce a 360-second 360 VR product. Hopefully have it by World Travel Market, and it's not a big process. It's very much easier to produce than you think. The technology with the cameras is literally changes monthly. But we're going to be able to now be able to take potential visitors to the destination on your website, on your smartphone, whether it be at a trade show. The goggles are huge now for the trade show applications. You know, I'm guessing in 6 months they'll be that thin, like everything else happens. So I think my message is there's a lot of innovation coming. Technology is changing everything we do. The internet, which when I began in this position 10 years ago, was kind of an afterthought in our marketing, and now it's the total centerpiece. Our media budgets are swinging more and more towards digital marketing, and I guess we'll swing more and more that way as we move forward. So, it's hard to keep, it's hard when you're trying to manage day to day to look beyond, but I think it's kind of a must, and what we do today is gonna be totally different than if we're standing here a year from now, would be my guess. So, thank you, and look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Fred. One piece of advice I'll give to everyone is just consider the following. Nassau Paradise Island in the Bahamas is 2% of the Bahamas' landmass, but gets the vast majority of the business that comes into the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. One of the big struggles every single year for the Bahamas is to let the world know that the Bahamas is a great deal more than just Nassau and Paradise Island. So I advise all of you, first thing you do at the end of this session, go and copy everything that he just said and apply it to your own destinations. Our next speaker really is essentially, in very many ways, is our host. Ms. Ingrid Rivera Rocafort is the Executive Director of the Puerto Rico Tourism Company. Please join me in welcoming Ingrid to the podium. Thanks.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Vincent, for the great introduction, and thank you, Frank, for a great summit. I've heard it's been very busy and very productive. I was asked by the team to talk a little bit, and I know I got 10 minutes, right, to talk briefly on the destination marketing and product development. And I have a couple of things that I do want to share that basically we're all tourism here in Puerto Rico. Part of the
the job and what we wanted to do is to continue developing Puerto Rico as an amazing destination for tourism, the center of the Caribbean, of course. I think every single island would say that, right? And part of the objective is to continue developing the economic impact of tourism in Puerto Rico. So we came in, established a goal, focused on a consistent strategic plan. We wanted to focus on being back into profit making as an agency, you know, right balance of growth, cost, and management. But this is an agency that does not depend from the government's funding. It's all, we basically have our own budget based on room tax and slot machine revenues. So we went to work quickly and planned our whole growth on five key strategies, which I'll just go through them very, very quickly. It was our guidelines for our business decisions. And basically by doing that, our work has really paid off. And I'll be sharing some very quick results in the last 3.5 years. We've had a strengthened industry over the past 3 years, despite SICA. And I'll share a couple of stats related to that. And in terms of revenues, you know, we were able to, in 3.5 years, increase almost by 26% our room tax revenues because more people came to Puerto Rico, more people stayed in more expensive places, and we were able to drive, you know, occupation. Quickly, five key strategies. We made every single decision based on these strategies. If it's not within strategy, it was off the table. Air and maritime access. We're an island. We need to get people to get here to Puerto Rico. And at the same time, you know, it was part of the objective of making sure we drove new airlines coming to Puerto Rico, new routes, as well as maritime access. You know, this is an important port for the rest of the Caribbean. We wanted to drive home port. We wanted to make sure more travelers would get to Puerto Rico and enjoy the rest of Puerto Rico. So that was a key important focus where we had outstanding people in charge. Product development, that meant more heads in the beds, more types of hotels, new products that actually impact and diversify Puerto Rico as a destination. Niche markets, gastronomy, medical tourism, sports tourism, marketing the destination, of course, the reason for being for the Puerto Rico Tourism Company, and service, which really means customer service, being able to be on top of making sure our product is top of the line and people feel welcomed and they want to come back to Puerto Rico. So in terms of maritime access, we're talking and that in 3.5 years, we were able to increase the number of airlines arriving to Puerto Rico to 13 new airlines, plus expand new routes with the existing airlines. You know, we have Volaris from Mexico. Avianca returned after 12-year absence, which is now going to be flying every single day from 5 times a week to 7 times a week. Air Europa from Europe, Iberia returning back to Puerto Rico. A new airline as Air, Norwegian Air, which brought us new destinations and new folks that never actually visited Puerto Rico from the Scandinavian countries. In terms of maritime access, we were able to break record in 14-15 with 1.5 million passengers in Puerto Rico from airline from cruise ships and new cruise ships arriving. Norwegian cruise lines coming back as home port. The mega ships being able to, you know, come to Puerto Rico from Royal Caribbean. That includes the Harmony, which comes now in December, Oasis class ships, Allure, the Quantum, etc., which provided us to be able to break that record. And we're poised to break that record from 1.5 to 1.6 in 17-18 already by the planned ships that will be arriving to Puerto Rico. Quickly, product development, the arrival of, or coming back, the Hyatt's hotels with Hyatt House, Hyatt Place, and four of them being open in the last 3.5 years. The first time arrival of AC Marriott, which will be launched now in February of 2017. The refurbishing and the relaunch of the Isla Verde area, with the purchase of new hotels, new buildings that will be going to be refurbished, the old San Juan Hotel, other hotels which are going to be having, you know, groundbreaking also in the area. Also a refurbishing of the Condado area with the opening of the Vanderbilt Hotel. And in terms of product development, the introduction of B&Bs, formalized, you know, certified and stamped, endorsed by the tourism company. Creation of posadas, which are small inns in small towns within the town to be able to develop the economic, you know, options for smaller towns with posadas. Green hotels, and, you know, pretty much I've been able to describe that. The third, and this is pretty much about that diversity of cultural, the experiences of beaches, the experience of adventure. It's just a snapshot of what Puerto Rico stands for and that and its diversity, sports tourism. In terms of niches, which are part of also this product development, are the creation of and certification of agrotourism. We have 6 agrotourism sites that have been developed in order to produce and to have as options new places and for people to have experiences which drive, you know, which are related to coffee harvesting, to riding horses and being in a horse farm that has been bred. The also routes, different routes, for example, taking the salsa route, which was just launched from San Juan and Santurce. You know, this is a country that where salsa actually takes place and it was born. So people want the experience of understanding and wanting to know more about salsa. The religious routes of all San Juan, the religious routes of the West Coast because of the churches and the cathedrals. I mean, the people want those type of experiences. So again, we did a script. We prepared and we certified guides. We have over 450 certified guides. And many of these, 16, 15, 20, have already been, you know, memorized the script and been able to produce and partner with tour operators to be able to offer these products. Creative tours, cooking tours, Toro Verde, which just launched its the longest zip line in the world as per the Guinness record, and new products like, for example, Terravista, which is where it will be holding the largest structure, the Christopher Columbus structures, larger than the Empire State Building, I'm sorry, the Statue of Liberty. And it will be launched now in February in the Arecibo area, which this decentralizes the attractions that Puerto Rico has above and beyond the metro area. The launch of Vivo Beach in Isla Verde, where people can actually have and spend a whole day in the beach with an environment, well taken care of, with umbrellas, with chairs, with concerts, and a great day trip for cruise passengers, for example. The Mall of San Juan, which was just launched last year, a great destination for tourists, because it's new, unique, fancy, high-end, but at the same time with unique stores. District Life, which will be announced shortly in the next couple of weeks, which is taking the convention center, which you have a beautiful convention center in San Juan. We had a great hotel there. 2 new hotels have been opened, so suddenly we have 3 hotels. A fourth one will be launched, and a district which includes bars, restaurants, entertainment centers, cinemas, which also then will liven up the convention area and actually, you know, helps us to create and maximize groups in the groups and convention business. And last but not least, a city sightseeing bus. It's a bus that's been around the world. We finally have ours here in San Juan, and it's it will be doing routes through all San Juan, in a way which is official and agreed to in terms of the streets, Isla Verde, as well as the Condado area. So those are the products, you know, product development, things that we have done, things that we have formalized and helped move along as the CTPR. Here is, you know, it's basically when I talk about the fourth strategy, we talks about marketing. It's being able then to have a complete consistent, unified strategy of how we serve Puerto Rico. And we've been able to successfully do that through the alliance that we have with TripAdvisor. And the idea to be able to be consistent, to be unified, and being able to make sure that that Puerto Rico sold, you know, in a strategic way outside in our targets in the U.S., Europe, and Latin America. And finally, and this is just a little bit of their video. There you go. And finally, I'll be part of a session related to Zika, but I do want to make sure that, and we'll extend the conversation in this area, but as an industry, we have, you know, unified. The Puerto Rico Hotel and Tourism Association, Meet Puerto Rico, which is the convention bureau, the Puerto Rico Tourism Company, and we've been able to put together an effort that has helped mitigate the impact of Zika here in Puerto Rico. And I do want to share this slide because Richard Tobin, which is an executive VP, corporate communications leader, he was a part of the U.S. Travel Association events. About 3 weeks ago, he mentioned how our program is to him, a best-in-class program. We didn't actually say that. He said that, so I don't want to share that. And I do invite everybody to be part of that session after we finish here. And finally, the fifth strategy, which actually talks about service and customer service, and how do we make sure that the experience is an extraordinary experience for the people that come to Puerto Rico. And part of that is being able to put together an effort that actually trains people and makes them proud about tourism and about this industry. And it's part of a campaign. And Nos Toca Brillar, it means it's our turn to shine. You know, we have to shine, all of us, each one of us. The wheel actually talks about, you know, the company is a solid financial structure. We reduce costs. We enforce the law in many areas, and we can talk about that separately. We create a new demand. We expanded air access. You know, we develop new products. We showcase in the world. We improve our product and also our service, and that solidly then gives us some certain results. You know, the fact is in the numbers. 5 million visitors, which was a 20% increase in 3 years. That includes also cruising. This had an economic impact of $3.8 billion, which is a 20% increase also in 3 years. This is part of a planning board numbers. Occupation 7.4 in 15-16, which is a growth of 2 points. Over 5 million room nights available. An increase in 27% of ADR in the last 3.5 years. Also, we're to 157 in 2015, an increase of 31% of RevPAR, 10 million passengers in all of our airports, reaching already by the end of this calendar year, we'll be at 9.1 million passengers going through our international airport, and that is an increase of 8% number of passengers. Of course, with 13 new airlines, 500,000 new seats, this is the impact. 1.5 million passengers in cruising, and we're already, you know, geared towards breaking that first record to 1.6 million in 17-18. It also helps dimensionalize, you know, we've been able then to increase that now that we have 11% of our passengers come from international hotel stays, with an increase of 40% in European visitors, and also, which is our main business, our main rice and beans, the U.S. traveler, 17% increase in U.S. visitors. So it's an issue of working together as an industry. And I just want to have and finish with this slide, because since you asked about opportunities, and probably this is some of the things that we'll be talking about. Puerto Rico, I mean, the good things, unique geographical location for continued growth in air and maritime access. There's a growing sharing economy. It's a reality of the industry. Let's do something about it. And we have done. I think I do want to share one number, which is really interesting. Well, I'll keep it in the Q's and A's. Competitive landscape and opportunities for growth for the region. The arrival of Cuba, the growth of the rest of the Caribbean. We want to make sure we continue that. Part of the success, consistency and message and continuity of the work done. Of course, this is something that's an issue also for travel, health issues like the Zika, security issues like we've seen in Europe. These are all globally affecting and tourism in general. We would probably want to discuss this as part of the Caribbean. And finally, in Puerto Rico's situation per se, you know, we're going through a debt crisis. We have a newly established economic supervision board, which is called Promesa or Promise. And it's also something that we need to work on and to make sure that we continue developing tourism as an important, a condition or a opportunity to continue making is a great solution for the economic development of Puerto Rico. We want to make sure that continues as part of that plan of Promesa. So thank you very much. I hope I made it in sort of 10 minutes.
Congratulations. Thank you very much. I mean, when we look at some of the stories that's coming out regarding Puerto Rico, I mean, this is the kind of story that I think really should be out there up front. So I can go back home and tell people the only thing I was infected by in Puerto Rico is your enthusiasm and incredible level of success under circumstances. Congratulations. You know, our next speaker, you don't see her name appearing in the lineup this morning, but as proof that is not an afterthought, you can go to page 31 and see her bio. Next speaker is Diana Plazas. Is it Plazas or Plazas? Whichever, Plazas, right. Who is responsible for digital and strategy development with Marriott for Caribbean and Latin America. We all know what has happened to Marriott recently, so her responsibility has expanded enormously. So please treat her with enormous respect because she is now just about everywhere in the Caribbean. So with that, please join us.
So thank you for having me. As I mentioned, as of last Friday, we now have 46 hotels in the Caribbean covering 15 different countries, over 200 hotels across the Caribbean and Latin America. And my role with Marriott, it's to support brands, marketing, and digital. So it's about being able to connect with what the brands are doing at our headquarters in Bethesda, and not only bring that to our individual hotels in the region, but then also ensuring that we're adapting those brand strategies to the markets where we operate and capturing some of that local traveler and allowing them to understand more about what our brands mean and what those different lanes mean. Interestingly enough, for Ingrid, we now have 13 hotels in Puerto Rico, so this market is extremely, extremely important for us across the different brands in our portfolio, ranging from our Ritz-Carlton Reserve in Dorado Beach, which is the top of the line. We also have our Courtyard, for example, in Isla Verde. So we have quite a variety of product that we have to be able to communicate with customers about. One of the great things about the Caribbean for us is the fact that most of the business for us comes from the U.S., and that also can shift when there are some of those challenges in the U.S. economy where we have to ensure that we're finding new opportunities and new markets. And my apologies, I didn't have slides because the part of the email was that we didn't really need slides, so I thought I would just talk to all of you today a little bit more about some of the things that we're seeing from a Marriott perspective. But it's really about being able to leverage what we have already established in the U.S. The company has been around for over 80 years in the U.S. It has established track record. We have brands that have been around that have a large footprint. So how can we partner with some of those brand teams to then start to showcase more of the new destinations in the Caribbean? How do we leverage things like the Marriott Content Studio that has created movies like Two Bellmen and French Kiss and Business Unusual to be able to start to narrate a little bit more about the culture and the experiences that you can have in the Caribbean? So that's been really a lot about what we do, but the five key trends that I wanted to talk to you about today that we're really relying on, that we're focusing where we go in the future, and again, how we leverage what is being done in the U.S., but then also what our hotels can do in their local markets, is around the fact that traditional branding ideas are still successful. You just have to make sure that you're adapting, that you're modernizing them, but they're still in front of the consumer. Consumers are still going to be watching TV. They're still going to be reading magazines, but it's about how, as Fred was mentioning, is how you use some of the new channels to be able to bring some of those to life. It's about crafting real and local experiences. We've done some great work with some student filmmakers that our agencies have been a great part of building that. It's about showcasing those true moments that you can have in some of the islands, which is a big trend, obviously. It's about experiences, and we get to be in this amazing industry where we're not selling tires, we're not selling mustard, we're getting a chance to actually create these amazing experiences, and it's about campaigns that showcase that. It's about being able to tell people the different moments that they can have in these destinations and what each brand could bring to them as part of that experience. But cleverly using social platforms is the third one. It's not simply about having a Facebook page. It's not simply about measuring how many fans you can have on your Facebook page, but it's more about it, how you're actually connecting with consumers through those social platforms. It is what that relationship is and what is the value that you're giving to those consumers that are following you on those social platforms, and where are you going a little bit above and beyond what they may experience from any of the other brands, and how individual hotels can also bring that to life, where they can rely on the brand pages that may have a million fans and followers, but how that individual hotel also plays a key role as a part of it, and how they can leverage some of the tools and the platforms that corporate may bring to them to be able to do it at their local scale and being able to make it to do so successfully. The fourth trend is really about using current events and being able to be in that in-the-moment conversation. We have also great things that are taking place day to day at our hotels, and how can we amplify that? How can we make sure that we are elevating that and we are making sure that more and more people are reached by it? We are, again, privileged that we get to have some amazing tools that allow us to track conversation that is taking place at the individual hotels or in the specific islands, in the specific cities, and how can we ensure that more people are seeing that? How can we ensure that we're part of that conversation without interrupting, that we're not doing it in a way that the consumer is going to immediately pull back and not want to interact? But again, it's about that idea of providing the value and being part of that current conversation, being part of that trend, whatever is becoming popular, but in a way that is actually meaningful and where your brand actually has a role, where we're not trying to bend it too far to just try and be a part of the conversation, but instead is about making it more meaningful and something that we can actually bring to life. And then the last one is really about finding innovative ways to reach consumers. And again, Fred went through a lot of it. Is, you know, mobile is the word that has been the buzzword for many years. I remember I've been in digital quite a few years, and it was always like, this is the year of mobile, this is the year of mobile. And now all the numbers truly show that it's about a 50-50, and in some cases it's even higher, where consumers are consuming and booking and really making a lot of their decisions through mobile instead of just relying on the desktop. So it's around finding those ways to use mobile, to use the different platforms that some of the advertisers allow us to, that some of the advertising platforms have, some of the ways to reach new consumers, some of the creative ways to present our brands, to present our hotels, and really is about working all together to be able to reach that and being able to be part of that entire journey with the consumer. So again, for us, it's really about tapping into those five trends, making sure that we are continuing to build our brands with the right consumer, highlighting some of our destinations, ensuring that when the teams in Bethesda are launching a brand new campaign for Courtyard that may be all about the NFL, that we're still finding a way for that campaign to have a play on some of the great hotels that we have in this region. That when Marriott Hotels is launching a campaign around TED, that we're able to partner with them and find those areas where they can have a Caribbean-specific theme or where they can have an event actually take place in one of our markets. So it's about that connection, and it's also about finding the new opportunities, whether it's with our airlines, with financial partners, and everything around the world, where we have that network for being part of Marriott. We can bring it local, but then also we can leverage the global scale.
So that was what I wanted to cover today. So thank you.
Well, you just heard how to go from important to extremely important in a matter of 1 week with what has happened at Marriott. Our final presenter is somebody who's known, I think, to many and most of us. He's the president of JetBlue Airways, Umang Gupta. Umang?
Thank you so much for having me here. Frank, congratulations. This is such an incredible event. Wow. I mean, just 2 years, this chief has become such a platform. So today, I actually was not going to talk about airlift, which it seems has come up quite a bit. I was not going to talk about innovation, but just show of hands, how many of you have flown on JetBlue before? Okay, so a lot of you. So I just, you know, I have to put this up before I start talking about innovation. We are, as of now, the largest airline from the US to the Caribbean when it comes to ASMs. We are the largest from, New York, we're the largest from Boston, we're the largest from Orlando. 29 destinations if you include Havana, which is coming up. 72 different routes, and I think it's close to 300 flights. We are completely committed to the Caribbean. This is, we started in 2002 with our first flight in international markets was to actually here in San Juan, and since then it has not stopped, right? 30% of our markets are here to the Caribbean, and we are going to continue doing that. We are incredibly invested, short-term, long-term. We continue to see growth. You know, just recently we added another flight to Grenada. We've added so many flights. So a lot more interesting stuff happening. And if you were to ask me, what's going to happen in the next 3, 4, 5 years? Well, there are some other airline partners in the room, so I won't say that. But hopefully we are you know, still the biggest airline to the Caribbean and serving the communities and working with our partners here. So anyway, switching gears, what I really want to talk about is innovation and transformation. And I think all of us have already seen that. If you just look back 3 to 5 years, how much the world of travel has changed, right? I mean, look at Uber, look at Airbnb, look at the, you know, personalization and what's going on with social media and TripAdvisor and how that's changing our business. It's going to continue happening, right? I mean, who would have thought like 4 or 5 years before that Uber was going to be what it is today? I mean, if you go to New York, you know, the yellow cab companies used to sell their medallions for over $1 million. So if you just wanted to drive a cab in New York, it was worth $1 million. And today, pretty much worthless because there's Uber, right? So what I'm trying to say here is we don't want to be the yellow cab company when the Uber comes along. It is incredibly important for all of us to have our eyes on what's happening in the innovation space, and it's not going away. This is just a chart that I found somewhere, actually a company that we work with, JetBlue Tech Ventures, which I'm going to talk about a little bit. But just look at how many startups are coming up in this space. If I knew which one is going to make it to the scale of Uber, well, I'm going to be a billionaire and hopefully not be here but on the beach. But there are so many of them, and some of them have incredible ideas, and they go across from inspire to compare to book to experience to share. There will be disruption happening in this space, and I think, and we don't have to be scared of it. It's actually, this is actually going to help our business. We just need to be aware of them, and we just need to be working with them and find the right trends and be ahead of the curve. So one more chart that I had was actually just talking about the speed of innovation. I mean, this is, I love this chart. This chart shows the time to reach to 50 million users. How much time did it take, right? Telephone, it took 75 years to get to 50 million, right? Facebook, 3.5 years. WhatsApp, less than 2 years. Temple Run 2, I don't even know what that is, but I assume that it's a game on iPhone. And you all know about Pokemon, right? I mean, things are changing at a dramatic pace. You can go from, I mean, Nintendo with the Pokemon got billions of dollars of value created in absolutely no time, in such a short amount of time, within hours of it being released, right? So just when I see what's going to happen in 3 to 5 years, it's mind-boggling. I don't even know. But we just have to have our pulse on what's going on. So that's sort of my advice to the partners here. So I mentioned JetBlue Tech Ventures a little bit. We at JetBlue are, you know, completely invested in this innovation game. We actually spun off a company called JetBlue Tech Ventures, whose only job is to go out. It's based out of Silicon Valley and works with us and tries to find out what are the new technologies coming up, who we can work with, who we can invest with, and how can we leapfrog and not be the yellow cab when the Uber comes along. And it's looking at the entire travel space, but the place that we have found an incredible match is in the travel-driven space, right? I mean, there are so many different technologies, but it seems like they're all fragmented. So when a customer comes along, it seems like they have to, you know, they have an airline experience, they have an experience to the airport, they have an experience to the resort, and it's all sort of disjointed and fragmented. And one of the opportunities that we have identified is to tie that all together and make that experience for the customer really, really seamless. So we're working with JetBlue Tech Ventures and a couple of other companies to do that. And in a couple of years, a couple of months, hopefully, we'll be coming to a lot of partners like you and trying to see how we can build this experience. This is actually a true story just from yesterday. I'm going to have to share this. I actually took a flight on JetBlue. Unfortunately, missed a connection. Haha, they couldn't wait for officer of the company. I was in Orlando, and you know, there was a flight departing to Ponce. And it was another hour or so, and I ran and I got it, and I had people who know people, so luckily there was a car waiting in Ponce, and they got me here. I got here 3.5 hours later. They were really nice. Our friends at Conquistador were really, really nice. I had a snack waiting just because I'm arriving 3 a.m. in the middle. Now imagine if you can do that for a customer, right? You land, you missed a flight, you know, you get something, hey, we see that you've missed, there's an option here to Ponce, just press the button, you're all set, and we've taken care of, your car is going to pick you up from Ponce, and by the way, we've got something waiting for you at the resort. Like, how cool would that experience be, taking all the stress out of a vacation? I mean, vacation is important. I mean, people take this once a year. How important would it be if we can actually turn that around and make that experience completely seamless? So that's kind of our vision, and we're going to be working with a lot of you, and hope we can, you know, continue this trend. Thanks.
Well, we have approximately 10 minutes for some questions, but I'll take 20 seconds to tell you a very quick story and tell you the definition of investment. As a wee young lad, as Director General of Tourism in the Bahamas, I decided there was a guy at British Airways that I really needed to spend some time with to get him to see what a variety there is in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And so we literally chartered an aircraft to fly him around from island to island to island in the Bahamas for him to see that British Airways could sail all these islands. Well, that young man really was impressed with what we were doing, except he went back to London and they promoted him immediately to another area, so all my investment went for naught. That young man today is now the president of JetBlue Airways, Robin Hayes. So that's the definition of investment. True story. If I may start with just one question. I mean, looking at the future, and I'd like just kind of a very quick question from each one of the members of the panel. Looking at the future from what you just described and what you talked about, if you had one more dollar to invest in terms of what you are doing today, where would you put that dollar? Anybody begin?
I would just go digital. I would go in just, but it's very, the targeted efforts is finding those right consumers with the right message at the right time, the right place.
Fred?
Can't do much for a dollar. but if I had a bunch of dollars, well, I think one of the things is continually keeping your content fresh and new, because I think our consumers and you know, you'd spend 50 cents on digital and 50 cents on content, because it's all about really showing the experience and bringing it to life, and that has to be, that's not a one-time deal. It has to be nonstop.
Ingrid?
Of course, I mean, digital, we're more than 50% of our promotion dollars are into that. But as a very close number two would be, and my colleagues here, airlines, you know, airline connectivity, being able to invest it with a co-op advertising, because as islanders, you know, we need to bring people in. This is new money coming in. As tourists, new money as investors, visitors, students who come to study in our island, in the case that where we have universities. So it, being able to have that air access, it just has amazing ramifications for the development of the island.
I would agree with the, digital as well. I would also add that digital from a customer experience standpoint, not just from a marketing standpoint as well. We have to think customer experience. That's what's going to be, that's what's going to make it a differentiated factor. That's what Caribbean can win at.
Great. Just want to get a sense of what your priorities are.